Here's been the prayer that's been going on for over 10 years now. I prayed that we would get so excited and just can't wait to be in the presence of the Lord that when worship and the word is being presented, we go crazy nuts when the pastor says, open your Bibles to. So open your Bibles to Nehemiah. Come on, church. This is the word of the Lord. Can you say amen? Listen, just hang tight, okay? Don't worry. You know I'm not long-winded, but that's okay. Y'all know IHOP is open 24 hours. I think they are, or unless they're still in the Rona hours, but don't matter, okay, guys? You'll have plenty of time to eat. Can you say amen? Amen. Nehemiah chapter 2. I'm going to skip some of the intro and go straight into the meat of the word, because I'm telling you, what's going on right here and what's already been spoken by the spoken word of the Holy Spirit, it fits perfect on where we're going today, especially where Nehemiah is right now. Can you say amen? I'm going to go through this. Y'all pray for me. Some good news, guys. I could not lift my arm up before service. Here you go right here, guys. It's awesome. Tomorrow I'm being called up. Where's Jeremiah? Tomorrow I'm being called up, Jeremiah, for the Houston Astros. They need help. And I know I'm not a cheater, so I'll get them the right way. And so you guys pray because it's getting better, guys. Can you say amen? All right. Nehemiah chapter 2, okay, is where we're going to be camped out today, okay? Last week we talked about do something, and week before that we talked about do something. Nehemiah got a personal vision. Can you say amen? Listen, he got so moved by the word of his homeland, a place he'd never even been, a group of people he hadn't even met, got so moved that he wept and prayed and fasted for days, church. Can you say amen? Listen, this is what's happening right here, church. We are being so moved that we as a body of believers are weeping for the Lord. We're not weeping because we're sad. We're weeping because we're being moved. There's people going, we're going to continue to pray. Amen. Continue to pray and fast and fall on our faces before the Lord so we can get more clarification as to God, what am I to do? Because do something is just half the battle. Can you say amen, church? We are being challenged to do something, but what does that look like? What are we to do? How am I to do? And this is where we find Nehemiah. In his word, if you back up just one verse, okay? So if you go back just one verse to chapter 1, verse 11, I believe. And it says, now I was a cupbearer to what? To the king. Now I was a cupbearer to the king. What does that mean to you and I, guys? I said this a little bit. Let me go a little bit more clarification of Nehemiah's job. The cupbearer was an important job. It really was. Not everybody can do it. It's a very risky job. Every drink, every article of food or whatever that was going to go to the king. And we know, guys, kings like to eat. How many here like to eat? Can you say amen? Yeah, you do. I've seen some of you. Oh, come on now. Say that in spirit. Hallelujah. King likes to eat. Likes to drink. Likes things to kind of happen, but in one way you can take the monarchy out is you just don't go up and assassinate them. You try to poison them, and so like this is what the cupbearer does. So he tastes everything before he goes to the king. As you can imagine, there is an incredible bonding and a relationship that happens with the cupbearer and the king. Let's keep in mind, Nehemiah is a Jew, the king is Persian. That don't mix, does it, church? He was born in captivity, weeping, being moved for a group of people, for a situation, a circumstance he's never been to, but he knows he's supposed to do something. But here's the problem with that. As a cupbearer, and some of you guys might have jobs similar to a cupbearer, you might feel like you're a cupbearer today, but the Lord's got a plan for you, so hang on. But as the cupbearer, Nehemiah just can't walk away from his job. Can you say amen, church? That's a problem. You can't just say, you know what, king? I'll be back next week, or it might take a few months, but I'll be back. The king can't fast for months, folks. I don't know. The word hasn't revealed it to me. I don't know who the substitute teacher was for the cupbearer. I don't know what happened there. But listen, some great things are happening, but he can't walk away. That's the problem, but God. See, one of the things about having this personal vision, one of the things about getting a word to do something, guys, stay with me. Now, one of the things about that is, listen, we've got to do something. We got to listen. But God can take that present circumstance that we're in and prepare you for what's next. That's how you do something.
Ooh, I thought that would get a bigger amen than that.
Listen, folks, we're in this waiting period. I understand it's hard to be like Nehemiah and be so moved, and you want to be right there. I want to be right there. I want to be right in the middle of what you want to do, God. I need to be in Jerusalem. They're in trouble. They are in ruins. This is when he gets the word now, they've been in ruins for about 100 years now. That's a long time for a group of people that desperately need help, and you feel like you're the answer, but what do you do? God says, I'm going to take that present circumstance you're in, and I'm going to prepare you for what's next. Come on, church, are you with me today? That's what he's doing. He says, I will prepare you. I'm going to use that circumstance you're in and prepare you for the purpose that I have for you. But there's more to this. Hang on. Here's a second observation I have with this. When God gives you a what, he will give you the how. When God gives you the what, he will give you the how. I don't know about you guys, but I'm going to go ahead and admit it to you today in front of my wife, my children, and my church family. I might seem to come across like I have a lot of patience. In some way I do, but I can't stand to wait. Really? My wife. How many just love the wait? No, nobody does. It pains us to be able to wait, especially when God lays something on you like a burden or a vision for something you need to do, but then you don't know how I'm going to do it. This was an impossible task for Nehemiah, guys. You understand this? It was a crazy dream goal that Nehemiah had. So you understand, he's never been there, doesn't know anything about it. He's not a builder, okay? I don't know about you guys, there's not very many. I know I'm looking at a room of guys that are very talented. Some of you guys do a lot of things with your hands. I understand that. I know I've been laughed at by even you people. I've got tools. I'm not sure what to do with a lot of them, but they look awesome, and they're organized, and they're clean. I don't know what to do with it. Sometimes I feel like Nehemiah. What do I do with these things? I know I've got to do something, but I don't know what. Here's where God wants us today, guys. Our responsibility is not to know how. Our responsibility is to be so focused on the what and sit and watch and wait for God to do the how. And I'm telling you guys, when he reveals it, it is awesome. Can you say amen, church? This is where we find Nehemiah. In fact, let's go on Nehemiah chapter 2. Let's go. We're going right here, guys. I'm going. Stay with me. And it came about in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, that wine was before him, and he took up the wine and gave it to the king. Now, I had not been sad in his presence. You're saying, what does that mean? If you're a cupbearer or you're in the presence of the king, you're not allowed to have a bad day. How many has ever had a bad day? You ever showed up at work and having a bad day? You ever done this mess? I mean, some of y'all do that at work every day. Okay? Oh, now he's preaching. In front of the king, though, you can't have a bad day. You can't be sad and have a bad day in front of the king. Because if you did, you were killed. Not killed. Killed with a capital T at the end of that. That is bad type. That's a bad way to be killed. Okay? Killed. And it says, so the king said to me, why are your face sad, though you are not sick? This is nothing but sadness of heart. The king's calling him out. Then I was very much afraid, and I said to the king, he's afraid because he's thinking, oh, I'm dead. Let the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad? When the city, the place of my father's tombs, lie desolate in the gates, and I have been consumed by fire. Then the king said to me, guys, here's the how. This is how God turns an impossibility into something incredible, and he'll use something like this or him to accomplish his task. What would you request? Now, you guys read that. Y'all weren't even moved by that. Do you understand how huge that is? All of a sudden, King Artaxerxes put on the Walmart vest and says, how may I help you? Guys, that right there will preach. I don't know about you guys, but that's the one thing I like about going to the Beast, a.k.a. Walmart, is I love to see those guys and girls in the best because I know help is right there. If I'm lost or if I need something, how may I help you is a very comforting phrase to me. But to Nehemiah, compound that by 100 gazillion times 10. I don't even know if that's a number. But that's what was happening with Nehemiah. When the king of Persia, to a Jew, a cupbearer, the guy that holds the entire life in his hands, and he says to him, "What can I do to help you?" Guys, are you with me today? God can use anything, anybody, any circumstance to prepare you, but then when he shows up and gives you the how, it is incredible, and he started with the king, and it gets better than that. The king says, "What can I do to help you?" "Well, I mean, since you're at it, how about your Lowe's card?" You're laughing. That's exactly what he gave him. "Do you need lumber?" You know what he says? This is the phrase that's been with me. I talked to Chris about this Thursday. This is the phrase that's been on me since Thursday. The phrase is this: "You got it." Y'all say it with me today on count of three. Ready? One, two, three. You got it. No, y'all said it kind of weenified. I'm talking about you got it. Ready? One, two, three. You got it. You need lumber?
You got it.
You need people to help you?
You got it.
Woo-hoo! Y'all are preaching with me today. You need credibility? You need letters of credibility so wherever you move, you won't be touched? Some of you guys have been sitting on a miracle, and you're looking at the what. Listen, Nehemiah was looking at a big old fat what. Now, here down here in East Texas, you guys know that's a language. Big old fat means big old fat. Something is, there's no bones about it. It's a big old fat thing, big old fat what, that's been staring at Nehemiah in the face. He knew exactly what needed to be done, but how do you do it? God says, "I'm going to use a Persian king, give you a Lowe's card, give you credibility, give you everything you need, and not only that, I'll give you maternity leave." Okay, he wasn't pregnant, but he was pregnant with a vision. That just hit me just now. Woo! The guy... Maternity leave. I should have called this title maternity leave over my sermon today. He will give you maternity leave because we're pregnant with a vision. We're pregnant with an awesome. I know, guys, nobody, you can't say pregnant in church. I get it. You're great with child. With vision. Guys, the Holy Spirit's been saying it since the instant we came into this place today. Some of you have been praying. Some of you mamas and daddies, you've been praying for your prodigal kid. You don't tell me that's an impossibility? Boy, I bled for that. I prayed for that this week. Somehow I was so burdened by that. That's an impossibility, isn't it, mamas and daddies? It hurts, doesn't it? That's a what? Many mamas and daddies have been sitting around going, "But how, Lord, are you going to do it?" You got it. It's not up to you to figure that out. See, here's the thing. Was it a good idea or was it God's idea that you're sitting on? You're saying, "What do you mean?" I've told you guys before that good is the enemy of best. There's some good ideas out there, but was it a God idea? You know what a good idea is? A good idea is something that you can do with your resources and your potential. Some of you guys are very talented. I get your potential. I get it. You know what to do with your tools. Good for you. Okay? Did my mic go out? Y'all can hear me, right? I don't need a mic. Hallelujah. Y'all hear me? I'll just yell. Okay, I can do this. Hallelujah. Test, test now. Oh, whew. Good idea. Your potential, your resources. God's idea. Come on, church. God's potential, God's resources. So listen, it gets better. Nehemiah was given a gold card to Lowe's with no credit limits, Why? Because it's a God's idea. Impossible, isn't it? Jerusalem's in ruins. He is a nobody. I don't know how to build. I sure don't know how to put together walls. I don't even know what this looks like. I got a very important job right here. I work for a Persian king. I'm a Jew. But somehow I've just been given maternity leave, an unlimited limit, credit limit on a Lowe's card, and I even got people and credibility to go with me. God, I love how you move because it's a God idea. Listen, church, you're sitting on a God idea. That's how you know the difference. You want to test the Holy Spirit on that? It's that easy. If it's something you can do, it's not God's idea. If it's something we can do ourselves, it's a good idea. But is it a God idea? God wants us, begging us, pleading us to be in His presence, stay in His presence, and listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit, because He'll tell you, I'll give you the what. Young people, He's giving you the what. He's giving you guys the what. Adults, mom and daddies, older mom and daddies. Y'all are sitting on the balcony. You're at home right now. This is for you. God's not through with you yet. God can use you, students. I don't care how young you are. You can flip your campus upside down. I know you can. That's an impossibility. Walking the walls, the hallways of your school right now that are crazy right now, and God's giving you guys a dream to flip your campus upside down and bring revival. That's a big old fat what. Now sit back and watch God give you the how. Moms and daddies, we're sitting on a what right now. I don't know what that is for you. But if it's a God idea, He'll give you the how. Just sit back and watch Him do it. And church, He's already starting that, and He's stirring that here this morning. This is why we have moments like this, because we get into His presence and we're moved. And there's a lot of weeping and praying in this place today. That's a good thing, church. Can you say amen? We are so moved by God, what you are doing, and we can't wait to see how you're going to bring it about. Because church, guess what? You got it. You got it. Would you stand to your feet with me today? So here's. Let me close with this, guys. We have an awesome altar experience, but let me close with this. A Christian without a personal vision, without a what, is a person without a mission. You're saying, what does that mean? Go back and read the Israelite story. Because you had a group of, this is what happens to people without a mission, they become complainers. They become complainers, and all they do is find things that are going wrong. I'm not saying that's happening here because this is the perfect church. But other churches out there who are not so perfect like us, you know I'm kidding, folks, okay? Because I'm a human that's leading humans. I get how it can operate. I guess I get how it can work. But it doesn't have to be that way. God's trying to raise up a mighty army that's going to be that's going out there and waiting for that how, guys. And if we're so consumed with the how, if you're so consumed with how God is going to do something, listen, guys, this is a good thing. While we're sitting back, consumed by the what, watching to see how God is going to do the how, there is no room for grumbling. There's no room for complaining. There's not room for all that. Because you're so focused on what's happening. And one last illustration I'll close with. I mean, Chris and I were talking about this, and he brought up the issue of Peter going out of the boat. You guys know the story. Jesus says, come on out. The what was what? Come on out, come hang out with me. No, don't look down at the water. That's I'm going to take care of that. And as long as he was focused and not worried about the how, did Peter walk? Yeah. But instantly he took his eyes off of the how and quit trusting and quit focusing. He started to what? Sink. Guys, it's that simple. Let's stay focused on the what. God's given you a what. And if he hasn't given you a what, that's not God's fault. That's on you. Keep listening. Keep praying. Keep getting in his presence, church. Can you say amen? Because I'm telling you, here's the overall vision from this pastor. I'll sum it up in one phrase. You know what the vision is for this church? That we are a collective group of believers that all share a what. And we're just passionately worshiping, praying, fasting, praying. And then after we do that, we what? We pray some more. Come on, church. Our prayer meeting should be bigger than this. That's churches that are movements when a pastor or a leader calls for prayer and we pack this place out. Why? Because we're anticipating, Lord, the how. It's not up to us to figure that out, Lord, but we're going to make ourselves and position ourselves right here, Lord. We're going to position ourselves in places where we can hear the how and see the how and watch you move. Folks, that's how it happens. That's the vision of this church. From the top to the bottom to at home or wherever you may be watching right now. Because you're just as part of the what right now. I'm looking right at you, church, at home. You're just as part of what's happening here. And Lord can even move you. And he's about to move you out of your place right there. Don't get scared. Don't get scared. The how is being revealed right now as we speak. You say amen, church? For those of you here in person, guys, hang tight. Hang tight. But let's be a group, a body of believers that share a what. Now, your what page is different from mine. Segan, your what's different from mine. Isaiah, maybe a little bit different, but maybe not. But it's shared.